Wonderful. Good morning, everybody. Welcome on this beautiful Friday morning to the Oregon Shakespeare Festival and today's CultureFest panel discussion, Creating Inclusivity in the American Theater. My name is Lydia Garcia. It is my pleasure to be your moderator this morning. And it is my great honor to welcome to the stage our panel of distinguished guests. Today, I am joined by Carmen Morgan, Project Director of Leadership Development and Interethnic Relations. Next to her, really needs no introduction, David Henry Hwang, Tony Award-winning playwright and social activist. Next to David, Sarah Bellamy, Co-Artistic Director of Penumbra Theatre in St. Paul, Minnesota. And of course, Bill Rauch, Artistic Director of the Oregon Shakespeare Festival. So we have an action-packed 90 minutes planned for you today. And in those 90 minutes, we have the impossible task of tackling an opportunity to hearing our esteemed panelists speak, as well as engage with you, our audience, in conversation about how we can create and foster inclusivity in the American theater. So for the first 60 minutes or so, we will focus on a fishbowl-style conversation among our panelists about their work in the areas of diversity and inclusion. And during that first hour, if you have questions, if you have observations that you would like to share, we encourage you to fill out common cards that you know, hopefully you picked up in the lobby on your way in, and to go ahead and submit those to us. You can just pass them to the aisle nearest you, and somebody will pick them up and collect them. So at the end of that hour, we will open up the floor in the conversation to include you, to include your submitted questions, comments, as well as live comments in the moment. So we recognize that 90 minutes is hardly enough time to examine the many issues surrounding diversity and inclusion. So don't worry, this is just the beginning of the conversation. And we encourage you all, we invite you to join us in the CultureFest Lounge, which is right next door to the theater in New Place, to continue the conversation. So just by way of giving you a little context of why, you know, why we're gathered here today, one of OSF's guiding documents is our value statement, which is a testament to the seven principles that form the pillars of our work at OSF, principles that are at the heart of everything that we do and that describe the way that we commit to working together. Those values include excellence, learning, financial health, heritage, environmental responsibility, and company. However, the pillar around which we gather this morning is our collective commitment to inclusion, which states, we believe the inclusion of a diversity of people, ideas, and cultures enriches both our insights into the work we present on our stage and our relationships with each other. So the drive to become a diverse and inclusive organization here at OSF shapes every facet of our work, from the plays that we present on our stages every year, the artists who perform in them and who help to shape the vision of them, staff recruitment and hiring, increasing access for people with disabilities, and audience development. So it reaches into every level of our lives here. So for our panelists, you know, with that in mind, I am going to ask the impossible, which is in about a minute or so, can each of you define for yourselves diversity and inclusion? What the diversity and inclusion look like from where you sit? Anybody want to go first?
Excellent.
I'll jump. Because then if I go, then I'm done.
There you go.
So in a minute. Well, I think for me, and this is personal and may also extend to Penumbra Theatre Company in certain kinds of ways as well. I think diversity is really about authenticity and about recognizing that exactly who each one of us are is our contribution and our gift to a community. And I often when people are doing diversity work, I think they think, oh, I'm going to go reach out to an other or the other. But the work really has to start with self. And so I think that would be a piece of it. And the other piece for me, diversity and inclusion is important, yes, but I really am pushing and striving toward equity. And that being a really important piece, and that's something I've learned a tremendous amount from Carmen about. She's been just an inspiring leader and teacher in that way. So that's my short answer.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
I will pile on in terms of the Carmen credit, but I think Carmen maybe first started coining this for us, that diversity is just a fact. Diversity already exists. We live in a diverse society. We live in a diverse country. Inclusion is what we're going to do about that fact. Mm-hmm. And are we going to create a place in which the fact of diversity is celebrated and people feel welcome?
Mm-hmm. That's great.
You know, I was lucky that the first person who ever produced my plays was the wonderful Joseph Papp, who founded the New York Shakespeare Festival and Shakespeare in the Park and in the Public Theater. And you know, Joe, back in the 60s, I think, was talking about creating a theater which looked like New York. And I still think that that's a pretty good guiding principle, that it's about creating art which reflects the population that it serves.
Okay, you know, I just have to do this sort of self-disclosure thing. When we said we were going to do this in the Thomas Theater, I don't know why I envisioned that I would be sitting in the audience, you know, and we'd be having a cross conversation. This whole stage thing has me totally distracted, and I'm only naming it so I can move beyond it. But
exactly.
The lights, the stage, I thought we were gonna, it was like, oh, we're just going to have a conversation in the Thomas Theater. Okay, so I would add to everything that I've just heard. I mean, the diversity is just the reality. And you know, something I feel like I have to kind of, you know, think about this in lots of different ways and analogies. And I was having a conversation several weeks ago, actually, with some incredible educators at Ashland High School. And you know, one of the things that came up was that, you know, their demographic at the moment is a predominantly white student population. And so when they talked about diversity, you know, there was a little bit of framing it in terms of, well, we don't really have that much. We don't have that much. And so we needed to break out of that, which is that you have what you have, and it's not just around race and ethnicity, obviously. It's around all the very complicated ways that people identify themselves and how those things intersect and more. And so one of the things I said was, so think of it that way, and then also think of it about the table that you are setting for the people that aren't even there yet. The people that you don't even know you're inviting. I think that's a piece of the inclusivity part. How can you create a culture and a climate for those folks that have not even started to knock on your door?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Fabulous. Well done.
So Bill, I'm going to send the next question your way. As leader of a major arts organization, what challenges have you encountered in your work to transform an organization in the areas of diversity and inclusion? So, you know, in your work here at OSF, what opportunities have you identified?
That's a big question.
It is.
Well, first of all, it's impossible to talk about diversity and inclusion at OSF without historical context. Mm-hmm. The Ku Klux Klan marched down Main Street of Ashland a few years before our theater was founded. There have been thoughtful efforts made about the diversity of our company and our work that go back so many decades. Henry Warrenitz, two artistic directors before me, was extremely proactive about casting in relation to racial and ethnic diversity in particular. Libby Apple was an incredible champion of diversity and inclusion, and her associate artistic directors, Penny Metropolis, and the extraordinary Tim Bond, did Herculean work that really contributed not only to this organization's health, but the field's health. The FAIR program that Sharifa runs, that's one of the most significant sources of energy on our campus, and an incredible contributor to the field was Tim and Libby's legacy, part of their legacy. So I just want to share, before talking about anything else, and even in your question, right, it was about transforming, but again, we all stand on the shoulders of all those giants, and everything we do is trying to build on those successes of the past and the challenges of the past. With that said, yes, rural Southern Oregon is historically a very white part of the world in terms of racial and ethnic diversity, and we're asking people not only to celebrate our own neighbors' lives, but also asking people to come to a destination theater. 85% of our audience comes from a couple hundred miles away or more. And so that the reality of the community that we live in is a challenge. I think that there's certainly been a lot of challenge. When I first arrived, I used to use the word change. When I arrived as an artistic director, the word change to me was just obviously, isn't that a great word? Change, change, change. Not recognizing that every time I use the word change, it could be felt as a dagger in the hearts of people who had been here a long time, that somehow change meant that what had come before was bad, was inappropriate, was invalid, was not valued. And of course, that's not what I meant, but I realized, I learned from listening to my colleagues that things were landing that way. So I do think the fear for anyone, when we talk about a shifting landscape, the fear for anybody who's in the dominant culture, whether that's in any part of one's identity, the fear that I'm being displaced, that I'm no longer valued, that I'm not wanted anymore, I think is very real, and that's an active pain that I'm not putting that in a hierarchy with the pain of being excluded, which is an extraordinarily active pain as well. But I think that's part of what we've been struggling with at OSF. On the good days, and we have a lot of good days here, we're making a ton of progress, you know? And I, in a way, going back to your first question, what does diversity and inclusion look like? It's like, well, it looks like OSF at our best moments. That's what it looks like, you know? So I'll hold it there for now. Did I answer the question?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Fantastic. All right, Sarah.
Yes.
I'm going to send the next question your way. What do you think is the role or responsibility of an art institution in achieving equity and social justice?
Mm-hmm. Well, I am a person who grew up in theater. My dad is the founder of the theater company where I now work. And
and directed two trains running
two
last
trains
year.
Running here.
An awesome
yeah.
production.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yes.
And I remember very early on, as a child, watching the actors come in, and you know they would joke with me and tease me and ask me about school, and then they would like transform into these different people. They'd go backstage and they would put on their clothes, their costumes, almost like putting on armor in a kind of a way, and their makeup was as if they were doing these rituals, and their lines, you know, rehearsing their lines, almost seemed like prayer in some way, and they would take the stage, and I realized the courage that they, you know, were embodying every evening to do that, and I was just in awe of them, and then to see the impact of their work in audience members who would come up to you know, we're in Minnesota, we're the largest African American theater company in the country, and we're in Minnesota, and. You know, 60% of our audiences are white folks, and so to see, for example, an older man from Duluth, white man from Duluth, come up to my father trembling and grab his hands and say, that was my father I saw up there. Thank you. That kind of power is incredible, and it's something that you have to use responsibly, but it's something that I think only the arts can do. The arts require us to see and recognize the humanity in a person who might seem superficially very different from us. And so I think we have a powerful tool to be, to use in these efforts.
And I think, you know, it's a space where we can model equity, where we can really look at ourselves in relief and see some of the challenging and not so great things that we do, but create spaces where we can have empathic, compassionate, and challenging conversations about where we are and where we'd like to go. And ideally, a theater is a space where everybody can be all of who they are, and we don't have to compartmentalize ourselves in certain ways. I also think the arts, you know, are daring. Like, we do this for a living. That's, you know, some people would be like, are you sure you want to do that? Why aren't we leading? The arts, you know, as a sector, should be on the vanguard of these efforts. We're brave, we're bold, and I believe deeply in our capacity to make change. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And, you know, I'd like to add to that, if
yeah,
I may.
Yeah, please.
Because this quote, I might be paraphrasing just a smidgen, but Tony K. Bambara says that it is the role of the artist to remind the activist that the revolution is possible. And I feel, from where I sit, because I love the, you know, Sarah's coming out of a tradition, a deep, rich tradition of theater. I'm coming out of a tradition of community organizing, activism, social justice work. And from that perspective, we have always seen the artist as allies. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, activists and artists have always been working arm in arm. I just don't think that we can do this work and sustain this work without the creative brilliance of our artistic community. We rely on that. So the role of theater, I mean, it is one of the most transformative mediums that mm-hmm. there is. And so from the other side, you mm-hmm. know, the movement building side, we absolutely need y'all.
Fantastic. Sarah, can I ask a follow-up question?
Sure.
Because actually, you've had a very busy week. Many artists, you know, but by way of a little background, many artists in the American theater community have been incredibly active in mounting local, regional, national responses to what's been happening in our country recently. You know, just you open up the newspaper and you read about, you know, what's happening in Ferguson, Missouri, for example. So Penumbra recently hosted, like 2 days ago, I believe, a community conversation about Ferguson. Can you share with us a little bit about what you learned or what you might have gained from that experience?
Absolutely, yeah. So at Penumbra, one of the programs that we offer is called Let's Talk. And, you know, semicolon, whatever we want to talk about. And usually these are planned events, right? So we do 4 every year. And it became evident to us that there was a need to have a conversation in our community about what had happened in Ferguson. And we weren't sure, it seemed in the Twin Cities, everybody was kind of waiting for another organization to do that. Mm-hmm. And we weren't sure what the right container for that conversation would be. And then we thought, well, it's us. Mm-hmm. I mean, why wouldn't it be us? Mm-hmm. That's what we've always done. Typically, we do plays that reflect society, and it's one of those questions, you know, chicken or egg questions. Does art reflect society, or is art, you know, all of sort of these sorts of things? You kind of lose yourself. Are we mirroring what's happening, or are we in some way creating what's happening? Mm. And I think it's always both. So we decided to have the conversation, and I think it was a test for us to see how nimble we could be. And how much care we could exact in creating a space where everyone would come and feel comfortable. Well, no, they not feel comfortable. That's the wrong word. Feel safe. Because I think the point was to trouble the waters. The point was to disturb and air that. And so what we did is I invited 3 panelists to join me. I invited a theologian, an artist organizer, and the new education director at Penumbra, and we had a really deep, profound chat with, you know, an audience that was packed, listening. And I always try to make room for artists to come in and share pieces, and so I had 4 artists, including 2 teenage boys mm-hmm. who are in our training program, black boys, share excerpted pieces. The boys had written monologues about the criminal justice system and racial profiling. And one of the artists read a beautiful piece by Claudia Alec that she wrote about her experience in Ferguson. And it was a remarkable event. I was so impressed with our community and our ability to talk to each other and be compassionate and go deep. One of the most profound realizations I had, the takeaway I had, was that Ricardo Levins Morales, the artist who was on the panel, artist organizer, we were talking about an image that a children's book writer and illustrator created in the wake of the event. I don't know if you know Mary Englebright's work. She's from St. Louis, and she depicted a mother, a black mother holding a child with a newspaper that said, "Hands up, don't shoot." And the mother was crying, and the child's hands were up, and the caption read, no parent should have to teach their child this in the USA. And she posted this on her personal Facebook page, and people went, you know, vitriol in response to this. Facebook actually took the post down, claiming it was offensive. Wow. And so I asked Ricardo, who was an illustrator as well, why it was such an explosive reaction, and he said, racism in America, in some ways, is like, when you acknowledge it, it's like airing abuse inside of a family. And that's why it's explosive. You told the secret. And we're not supposed to do that. And so he said, we can't talk about where we are because we're not supposed to acknowledge where we've been. And we can't talk about where we're going because that would acknowledge that it's still happening right now. And so this idea of America as a family that's an abusive family that's suffering and needs to acknowledge and then heal was profound for me and profound for the audience. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, this idea that a children's book illustrator prompted that realization was a big takeaway for me.
Yeah.
But it was a great conversation. Mm-hmm. I will tell you, as the person facilitating it, it was exhausting. And I was nervous the whole time. But we did a good job, and the community did a good job, and I was proud of us. And I think you have to celebrate. You know, you have, because this work is hard, and you have to celebrate those moments when things go well. So I was happy with it.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Fantastic. Fantastic. Bill, OSF also had a response, right, to the Ferguson events. How were we involved, represented?
Three members of our staff, Claudia and Mika Cole and Sharifa Joka, went to Ferguson to do some research and development work on potential future artistic projects and just to be on the ground. And I was so grateful to those three colleagues for having that impulse and for following through, you bet. And the piece that was read of Claudia's came out of that visit. Mm-hmm. If there's anything any of you want to add about your time, it'd be great to hear it. Mm-hmm. Even though it's not time for the audience yet. We can break rules, can't we?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Anything you guys want to say?
So we were there for about 3 days, and the last day we were there, and this was before we held some kind of large artist gathering to connect, we went to go see a youth theater company. It was a Black Repertory of St. Louis, and it was their youth group, and it was a powerful, beautiful piece of theater where the students had been learning for 2 weeks about Black history, and of course their work was responding to what was happening in their lives. And at the very end of their piece, where they took us through slavery and the Black arts movement and to contemporary hip hop, at the end, they all said what their actual dreams were. You know, little kids saying, I'm gonna be on TV one day and I'm gonna be a scientist. And then they said, hands up, don't shoot. And I just sat there thinking, this is what theater is about. The moment was provocative and beautiful and healing, and it made me proud to work in theater.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Can I just very quickly follow up on that? The reason why we chose to read your piece was in response to a question I put toward the panel about what happened in Illinois. I think it was the Edwardsville School District, in which the superintendent asked teachers not to talk about what happened in Ferguson, to ban conversations in classrooms, and if students talked about it, to change the subject. And so the question I put to the panel was, what are the developmentally appropriate ways we can talk about this? And what they did at St. Louis Black Rep was so beautiful, because it provided us with an alternative model. And I think it also really demonstrated the importance of African American arts institutions as containers for these conversations around, in particular, racism, you know, and the African American experience. So it was such a gift that you wrote that, and the audience just loved it. So thank you, Claudia, for that.
So David, you have a long and distinguished record as an artist, activist, working to expand representations of personal cultural identity in the theater, probably most famously in the controversy around the casting of Miss Saigon and Broadway in the 1990s, and of course many, many other you know, movements since. How has your advocacy work shaped your evolution as a playwright in the way in which you work with the theaters to produce your work?
Well, I mean, I want to go back to, Sarah, what you were talking about in terms of authenticity and the creation of work. Because, you know, when I first started wanting to be a playwright, I wasn't interested in most of the topics that I've ended up writing about. I just wanted to be, you know, I didn't have any particular awareness or consciousness of myself. I mean, I knew I was Chinese American, but I didn't think it was particularly important. And then the summer before my senior year in college, I was home, I'm from LA, I was home and I saw an ad in the LA Times that said, study playwriting with Sam Shepard. And I was a big fan of Shepard's. And so I clipped this ad and sent it in, and it was the first year of something that for many subsequent years was a pretty prominent event in Southern California, the Padua Hills Playwrights Festival. But this was only the first year that they ever tried to do it. So there were only two of us that applied to be students, so we both got in. And so at Padua, I, you know, got to study with Sam and Maria Irene Fornes and Murray Medick and Walter Hadler, and a lot of people, wonderful writers, who taught us more to write from our subconscious, you know, to write from places that you don't understand. And when I started doing that, all these issues started appearing on the page, you know, things like clash of cultures and immigration and assimilation. And so clearly, some part of me was incredibly interested in these subjects, but my conscious mind hadn't figured that out yet. And ever since then, writing has been for me a way to hold the mirror up to myself internally and find out how I really feel about things. And, you know, in terms of as sort of a personal adjunct to this question of what's the relationship between arts and the society, it is, you know, I think it represents the reciprocal relationship between the work and the artist. That is, you know, I discovered that I was interested in these subjects through the work, and then my interest has then shaped the entire rest of my life. So that, you know, in a literal sense, the artist creates the work, but it is equally true that the work recreates the artist, you know, and I feel like that's the reciprocal relationship. So now, as it relates to activism, I mean, yeah, you were talking about the whole controversy over the quote-unquote yellowface casting of Jonathan Pryce in Miss Saigon in when Miss Saigon came to Broadway in 1990s. But, you know, in some sense, I need to contextualize that as 10 years prior to that, in the late 70s, there was an incident where, getting back to Joseph Papp, where the Public Theater did a play called New Jerusalem by Len Jenkins in, I think, about 78. And they cast a Caucasian actor in an Asian role, which led to protests by the Asian actors of that day, that was yellowface casting. And Joe Bing, who he was, he had the protesters come into the theater, into his office, and eventually hired one of them onto his staff, with a brief to find roles for Asian actors. And it was just about that time that my first play, FOB, came across their desk. Mm-hmm. So I'm basically the beneficiary of affirmative action. I mean, that's what affirmative action is. It's mm-hmm. there was a slot that was created for someone like me, mm-hmm. and I was the guy who got to walk through it. Mm-hmm. And so if, you know, coming from that place, it therefore becomes, I think, incumbent upon me or necessary to then, when a similar incident mm-hmm. pops up 10 mm-hmm. years down the road, and by that point I'd done M.Butterfly and, you know, I had visibility, that's what you got to use it for. I mean, that's why I was put there. So I've tried to be a good steward of the trust that was placed in me.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Exactly. In the years since, having that feeling of using your visibility, using your standing in the theater, how do you find that your views have evolved since then? Do you feel that we are making progress? That sense of affirmative action, the way that we program voices of color.
I feel like I've gone through a lot of different phases about thinking, mm-hmm. Thinking on these issues, which is, I think, appropriate. I mean, mm-hmm. hopefully I'm not the same person I was when I was 20, otherwise, what was the point of the last 30 years, really? I think that there was a certain point in my life when I was much more sort of what I call an isolationist nationalist. You know, I just wanted to work with other agents and stuff, and then I moved on from that, and I went into what then became multiculturalism, and then I started to feel that multiculturalism was sort of a little silo-ish, and could lead to, and so then I became more interested in kind of what's called transculturalism now. So there's all these different, kind of terms and ways of thinking. But as it relates to this question of, have we made progress, I think it really depends what time frame you measure mm-hmm. that progress over. Mm-hmm. If I compare it to 1980, when my first play was produced, I think we've made quite a bit of progress in terms of major theaters in this country at least recognizing the desire to have more diversity, more inclusion. I don't know that people can exactly figure out how to make that happen, and that's where I think the actual progress that has been made has been slower than even a lot of institutions, I think, would like it to be. Mm-hmm. But the reality is, let's just look at the issue of casting. I mean, it's hard to come up with statistics, but there is a group in New York, APAC, which just crunched the numbers for Broadway theaters and I think it's the 10 or 12 major not-for-profit theaters in New York. Mm. And for over a period of like 6 years. So they broke down the casting by ethnicity. And roughly, it varies from year to year, but roughly you have about 80% of the roles in theater being cast with Caucasian actors. Mm. So I think that we would have to say that in any field, that's not a good diversity statistic. And I think that the field as a whole would go, yeah, that you're right, that's not a good statistic. But people, again, don't seem to have figured out yet how to improve that number.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Exactly. Yeah, Bill, Sarah, as leaders of institutions, how do you feel that artistic leaders can help to address these issues? In programming, recognizing that, of course, all of our theaters, both large, small, mid-sized, have different missions in what guides their work. Do you have insights, advice for your fellow arts leaders?
Oh, thank you. So the question is complex because mm-hmm. every arts organization should have, I think, a diversity and inclusion and equity plan, and that includes theaters of color. Mm. So, for example, where we were challenged, we're challenged in terms of accessibility issues. We're challenged in terms of we still have male and female bathrooms in our facilities. We you know, so we decided this season, and you know, we're a mid-sized arts organization. We don't have a huge budget. We decided that we would dedicate all of our plays this season to women's voices. And so that is one thing that we could do, you know, as an African-American theater company. I think another thing that we can do is collaborate with other theater companies. And my father has built some really healthy relationships with regional theaters across the country. And, you know, finding partnerships like the work that, that you and Lou are doing here. And I think that... one of the challenges, though, with collaborations, especially between theaters of color and other theater companies, is understanding that even though our budget size may be smaller, we're coming with a lot to offer and a lot to put on the table. When we go back to that idea of authenticity, our communities value and trust us. And that is a huge thing that we're bringing to a conversation about partnership. Our cultural capital needs to be recognized. Those are things that I don't really think that you can put a dollar figure around, but it's important that that's named at the table, because I think a lot of times there's this excitement for smaller theater companies to be partnering with a larger theater company, and they don't articulate their value and what they're bringing. And so we're doing a lot of conversation in the Twin Cities now around equitable collaborative projects and partnerships, and it's hard, you know? I mean, it's not a one-size-fits-all thing. There's no cookie-cutter formula. Every relationship has to be organically built, and it has to be done over a period of years. You can't just do it a one-off and then expect that, you know, you're going to hit the right mark the first time. So I guess that would be a starting place. I don't know if...
That was great.
Oh, thanks.
Thank you. I like listening to you talk. For us, as a large-scale classical theater company... there's just the overwhelming history of gender inequity and the dominance of white writers, and starting with our namesake playwright, you know, who is obviously a white man. Trying to create a season, because it absolutely starts with the work. What are the stories we're choosing to tell? Who wrote those stories? And what artists are required to best interpret those stories on stage, backstage, and who then wants to come to experience those stories. It all starts with what the stories are. So that's part of why we've looked at expanding the definition of the classical repertoire, that it's not just Shakespeare, Moliere, Chekhov, et cetera, and so many of the great European writers and great American writers of past eras. Although we love those authors and will continue to produce those authors, we've also looked at Sanskrit epic, at Nigerian play, at Japanese and Chinese stories that are old and classical, and that feels essential. And we've talked more and more and more about gender inequity. And this season is the first time that four of our seven non-Shakespeare plays are written wholly or in part by women. And you know, I'm parsing that so carefully, because I have to, because Shakespeare is our middle name, and we love the works of William Shakespeare and everything that Shakespeare's work stands for. In terms of its energy and its vibrancy and the way in which Shakespeare explored incredible diversity of society and the politics and the spirituality of the plays. It goes on and on. So Shakespeare is our standard and our inspiration in so many ways. But in terms of the authenticity of voice, in terms of diverse cultural perspectives, it's hard work for us as a classical theater, and exciting. Now, obviously, with the new work, there are, of the many, many, many writers we've commissioned, we want to always be thoughtful about the gender diversity and racial and ethnic and every type of diversity of our larger society, and how that's reflected in the playwrights we're choosing to invite in to create something with us. Mm-hmm. And we're always so happy when they say yes.
Can I just quickly follow up on that?
Sure.
From an institutional perspective, I also sit on the board of directors for the Theater Communications Group, and I am the diversity and inclusion chair of that board. And I have to say that the rigor and the tenacity and the commitment to the hard work you're doing is such a beacon and is so important for our field, because you're saying that Oregon Shakespeare Festival can do it. Mm. And that is so important, right? Because, I mean, I look at, you know, our regional theater, the Guthrie, is having a lot of difficulty, and they're presented with very serious challenges that they're grappling with. Mm-hmm. And to have, you know, a flagship theater to say, well, if they can do it, we can do it, right? Mm-hmm. And so it's so important that that's being modeled, and it's such an important place to hold in our field and in the country, and we're very grateful for the work that you're doing. So keep it up.
Thank you for that. It's awesome.
Fantastic. Sarah, I'm going to piggyback on you just bringing up Theater Communications Group, which is our flagship umbrella organization representing a multitude of theaters in the United States. And to ask Carmen, you know, Carmen, there's been a surge of action in recent years within major national arts institutions, organizations, to talk about, to advance, you know, having greater diversity and inclusion in the American theater. So, you know, from where you sit, as, you know, as a community activist, as a scholar, as a, you know, I think for so many of us, a luminary, a guiding light in this work, why is the movement happening now? You know, are we witnessing a larger national moment?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. You know, I would like to say that it's just a growing moral imperative, and that theaters are finding, you know, their way, and they're seeing that this is their role and responsibility as institutions that serve the public good and, you know, need to be equitable in that way. But I do think that there are other factors involved. I think that, you know, certainly I think that folks were galvanized after the 2010 census when they saw just a huge upsurge in the diversity of our nation. It was tracking much faster than they thought it would from the 2000 census. And I can certainly tell you in community organizing and activist communities and a lot of the nonprofit organizations that have to provide services to this diverse population, they were tracking these things way before certainly the politicians were, and certainly before some of the cultural institutions. So for a lot of those folks, when they saw the 2010 census, it was like, yeah, this is our nation, these changing demographics. And so we're now tracking that by 2042, and listen, I will tell you it's going to happen before 2042, but the projections are that by 2042, the United States will be majority people of color. And right now, I happen to live in a city that is predominantly people of color, within a state that is predominantly people of color. And I can just tell you that, you know, this is just the reality, and I don't say it as a, you know, I don't think that it's a threat, but I do think that that is part of it, is that folks are recognizing that, that these changing demographics mean that we have to really re-envision, we have to speak to our community, our communities changing. And I also think that, another piece that's happening is within the theater community, and I don't know why it's not happening as much in some of the other artistic places. It's happening there, but it's just happening with such energy in the theater community. I do think it's a combination of two things. I think that there are these culturally specific theaters who've been holding it down for a long time. I mean, Penumbra is one of those theaters, as well as East-West Players in Los Angeles, our colleague and friend Tim Dang, who's been doing this work, the oldest Asian Pacific American theater in the nation, Native Voices doing work on behalf and for only new playwrights coming out of the Native American, Alaskan Native, and our tribal experiences, only new playwrights. I mean, this is the work that they've been doing. Teatro Campesino, who's so we have culturally specific theaters that have been doing this work and holding us accountable to communities of color, having a relationship with communities of color. Thank goodness when some of the larger, predominantly white theater institutions have not been able to keep those relationships going. So I think that that's happened, and I feel like that those relationships and that commitment to having theater have a relationship with communities of color has been serving us well. Mm-hmm. And I feel that they've been sort of tilling the soil and holding it down for all these years. And now I do feel that, you know, they've been sort of keeping this stew ready for us. And now some of the larger theaters like OSF and others are saying, you know, listen, we've got to recognize that our communities are changing, these demographics are shifting, and we have to be accountable. I love the sort of the shout out that Sarah made about OSF, because in my work, when I'm talking to other theaters around the nation, you know, theaters that might be in larger communities, metropolitan communities, maybe they're in New York, maybe they're in LA, and they say, oh, it's so hard, we can't, how can we, you know, I mean, it's just such a challenge to get this diversity, and we can't, and I say, you know, let me tell you about this little place called Oregon Shakespeare Festival. You've got Shakespeare in your name here. We're in Ashland, which is a beautiful city, but folks, it's, you know, the demographics here. And, you know, Bill Rauch's vision, and yes, all of what came before it, the foundation and mm-hmm. Cynthia's vision and leadership, there's like, we are taking no, there is no excuse. How do you decide when you're in Ashland, Oregon, leading with Shakespeare, that you want to match the demographics of the nation? Who does that? And then proceed to do it. So I feel like Sarah's right when she says that, you know, OSF is a beacon, folks. And I know that the folks that work here at OSF, I'm telling you, you don't still yet get your national reputation because you're here. But I am telling you that there is not a conversation that happens about this issue that the point of reference does not come back to OSF. So you may not want to keep holding it down, but folks are looking at you. And I also want to say that there's a relationship with the OSF audience as well, mm-hmm. That folks are saying, I hear folks say, well, you know, that OSF audience is, you know, I mean, they expect no less. They expect it and get. So I could go on this because yeah. I feel like there is something palpable. It is a little different. There is some momentum, and it's a confluence of those institutions, those culturally specific institutions that we've got to support them. They've been doing it with little to no resources, mm-hmm. Creating and supporting and sustaining playwrights of color that have not had the same kind of opportunities in some of the larger white institutions. They've been holding it down all these years, and now these white theaters are playing catch up. And luckily, OSF is one of them that's taking a lead on that. So I think that that's happening. And quite frankly, look, the changing demographic. Folks, what is your audience going to look like in 30 years? Mm-hmm. If you have not asked yourself that question, if you've not looked, yeah, you know, I think that has helped the conversation.
Can I just add something? Because mm-hmm. the whole demographic change is huge. And, you know, I feel like there may have been a time when one could go, oh, well, we're supposed to become more diverse because it's the right thing to do, mm-hmm. either politically, socially, aesthetically, whatever. At this point, it's also a business imperative. Mm-hmm. I mean, yeah. There's no industry in America that doesn't realize that it needs to become more diverse and serve a diverse audience in order to survive.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And certainly that applies to theater as much, if not more so, than anybody else. And even, I mean, I think, you know, Hollywood is a huge ship that is incredibly difficult to turn, mm-hmm. and they generally don't do a very good job of it. You see, this season, ABC actually is really making an effort to try to become a diverse network.
Yeah.
And we'll see if the shows run or not. That ultimately is going to be a huge arbiter in Hollywood as to whether or not other people decide to kind of ape that effort. But anyway, it's, you know, it's a business imperative now.
If I can just join in here too, I completely agree with the business imperative. I agree with the reality of shifting demographics and the need to be responsible to our communities, the ethical, the moral imperative. But the other thing, not but, and, diversity makes the work better.
Yeah.
It just always does. And when Howie Segoe, who's been a member of our acting company now for years, brings his language, American Sign Language, onto our stages, the work is richer for it. Mm-hmm. And you know, we can go on naming example after example after example, but new perspectives, different cultural perspectives, new languages being introduced into the work makes the work richer. It makes the work more reflective of the world we live in, and that makes the work more compelling and more worth watching for me as an audience member and as an artist.
I think Absolutely. It also makes it more relevant. I mean, to kind of bring this conversation full circle, it is such a powerful thing to see yourself and your community represented. I mean, that is such an affirming, life-giving experience. And so for kids of color to be able to turn on the television and see families that look like theirs, to read literature that represents their experience, that's powerful, and it can help people stand up in the potential of who they are. The flip side to that is the realization that it does do that, and there are communities in the United States that are trying to combat that right now. For example, the Texas School Board, or in Arizona, there were conversations about taking ethnic literature out of English classes. Mm-hmm. Why? Because they know that students, if they read about themselves in positive ways, they'll feel compelled to participate in society as adults, and they may change how things are going. Uno Diaz, an incredible fiction writer, talked about the creation of what he called cultural vampires. If you can't see yourself reflected, you become a sort of a monster to yourself in these ways that are insidious and start to permeate families, which start to permeate culture, right? And so it's important that we recognize that when you allow space for someone to recognize themselves on stage, that it is a life-giving and affirming thing that you're doing. And so we do need to support writers of color. We do need to support people who never get the chance, you know, in so many different ways, the trans community, right? All of this conversation that we're having, there's been some beautiful pieces through the TCG blogs about ability, right? And thinking about representing different kinds of ability on stage. And so I think what we're trying to do is really wonderful. One thing that does frustrate me inside all of these conversations is the sense that, like, when's it going to be my turn? When does my community get the microphone? What about, you know, and it's, what about all of us? How can we all, and that's where I think Carmen has been, and I love your calling her a light, because she absolutely is in the field. Carmen is doing beautiful work with Theater Communications Group that is permeating the American theater landscape. That is not an understatement. And she is so rigorous with all of us to say, okay, you're doing great on that. What about these folks? You know, celebrate, but you can't forget about, you know, and it's so important that we have that kind of leadership and that reminder. Because the work's never going to be done. That's the thing. it's a life path. It's not a, like, okay, I took my culture pill, I'm done. You know?
Exactly. I love that. Yeah. Well, I mean, so recognizing, I mean, first of all, the epic scale of the work that we are tackling, that the lifelong, you know, reality-changing work, really, that we are talking about doing here, and the moral imperative, the financial imperative, just the reality that the world is changing. You know, I want to recognize that, you know, we're not just talking to ourselves here. We are, in fact, sharing a room. We're under the same lights with our audience. So I would like to ask all of you, actually, what is the audience's role in helping to shape diverse, inclusive theaters? You know, how can you, as our audience, for example, you know, support a movement towards greater inclusivity, greater diversity? And more importantly, how can our audiences hold us accountable as artists? Does anybody want to start us off?
Well, I'm gonna throw some stuff out there. I hope you don't get upset. Just a quick story. You know, I had the pleasure of having a wonderful conversation with a man who lives in the Bay Area, lives in San Francisco, and he was talking about, with some emotion, what a wonderful experience he had in the most diverse audience experience he'd ever had in his life. He was watching an August Wilson play for the first time in his life, and seeing a fabric of American culture that he had never been exposed to before, with the most diverse audience that he'd ever been exposed to before. Now, you know, he lives in San Francisco, and he said, you know where I was having that experience? I was having it at OSF in Ashland, Oregon. And he said to me, that I will pay for. I will give my money to that kind of an institution to create that kind of an experience for me. So I feel like it's important to talk about it in that way, that this is not just about, well, you know, let's have artistic representation because it's, but it allows all of us to see each other in a more human way. John Powell, if you all get a chance, look up the research that John Powell is doing. He's a professor right now, I believe it's Stanford or Berkeley. And he is talking about, for a long time we have thought that some of us see others and we don't see their humanness. Mm-hmm. We've thought that. Now we have science to back it up, where they have tracked the way in which, what part of the brain lights up when you see certain racial and ethnic groups. Mm. And I have to say, I'm sad to say that some of the results are shocking and not very optimistic. Mm. So what we know now is scientifically that some of us look at other communities, look at other races, and don't see human beings there. They're not human. The connection I'm making is what this man talked about when he saw his very first August Wilson play and saw the humanness expressed on stage, and the fact that we know that some of us don't see all communities as fully human, and the potential there. Mm-hmm. And so what the audience can do is, well, what the OSF audience does is expect that, mm-hmm. come to expect that. When I come into a community or an environment, an organization, an audience, and it's all white, I think to myself, that's not a coincidence. Mm-hmm. What's underlying that? Mm-hmm. Let's interrogate it, mm-hmm. right? And let's expect that we're going to have a reflection of the real people that live in these communities. So I think one of the things is hold these organizations accountable. They are here for the public good. These are resources that should benefit as many of us as possible. Put your money there. Support culturally specific institutions that have been doing this work for so long, even if you don't live in those communities. Go on Penumbra's website. Take out a membership for Penumbra, East-West Players, Teatro Campesino. Many organizations, culturally specific theaters, support them. Please don't let them languish. Mm. And then, by all means, hold those predominantly white now institutions. They're predominantly white now, but that's going to change. I mean, we already know about the demographics. But hold them accountable, because in the meantime, we still need to hold them accountable. Tell them you expect no less.
Mm. Please. Oh, okay. There's a couple things that I think I want to talk about. I'm going to name them so I don't forget the second one. Mm. The first one is about theaters of color and diversity. The second one is about audiences being critical consumers of art. Can you all help me remember that?
Yes.
I want to come back
yes.
to that? Okay, thank you. So I had a question from a reporter in the Twin Cities, the Guthrie Theater. Do you all know about the Guthrie Theater? Big
yes.
theater, awesome theater, really cool space. It's like a big blue box. You get vertigo in there, but anyway. So I had a reporter ask me, if the Guthrie successfully diversifies their work, will we still need Penumbra Theatre?
Mm.
And it hurt my heart for a lot of reasons. The first being, Penumbra doesn't exist to diversify the Guthrie.
Right. Right.
Penumbra Theatre exists because we need a space where African American art and culture is represented, and it's not going to end once a white organization diversifies. It's going to continue. We're going to still live and still make art. Okay. The other is the sense that everything has to be surrounding the largest organization in the area. And I think one of the things that I've seen you take leadership on is these partnerships. And saying, you know, and that was, the Guthrie was doing that with in the Twin Cities for a while, saying, for example, if we're going to do an August Wilson play, we got to talk to Penumbra. You know, they were the first theater company to give him his first professional production. They've done more of his work than any other theater company in the world. We got to talk to him. And so we partnered. Mm-hmm. Was it hard? Yes. Was it messy? Yes. But recognizing that there are experts in your area is really important. So, culturally specific theaters, theaters of color, are valuable in and of their own right. And knowing that as audience members is really important. Mm-hmm. We need your support. When I go to the second point about critical consumers of art, that's something that we try to foster at Penumbra. I would say our audiences are really educated. They're passionate about the work. And that's something that you can do actively as audience members, is become critical consumers of art. And there's something, a really special role that you can play that I would ask you to take up if you feel comfortable doing. When communities who are underrepresented on stages tell you that they're upset about the representation of their people or cultures, believe them.
Yes.
They
yes.
know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
When they say, that depiction of my culture and people is wrong and injurious, listen to what they have to say.
Absolutely.
And talk to the artistic directors, talk to other audience members, figure out what they're upset about. Because believe me, the representation of people and cultures matters.
Yes.
It influences what we come to believe about individuals and communities. It influences our core values, mm-hmm. and that determines our willingness to allow access to people. Mm-hmm. And so that's a really simple thing that you can do, is be willing to listen. When there's protest, it's not over nothing. Mm-hmm. So those are my two suggestions.
That's
for
awesome.
Audiences.
I want to build on your talking about culturally specific organizations and the value that they bring. I think artistic expression, like time, is something that's precious and that can be spent wisely or poorly. You know, you can change the world in 5 minutes and you can waste a lifetime, right? Mm-hmm. Depending on how you choose to spend your time. And I think in the same way, the biggest budget arts organization in the country can be doing nothing to move the dial on our society. Mm-hmm. And a small, budgeted, vibrant, culturally specific organization can be the one that's changing the world. Mm-hmm. So this idea that bigger is better, and the bigger the budget is, the more validity an organization has. There are traps that come with size also.
Yeah. Yeah.
I just want to go back, Carmen, your story about that gentleman in the August Wilson play is very moving. I'm so happy he had that experience. At the same time, the majority of the racial and ethnic diversity in OSF audiences live in our student audiences.
Mm-hmm.
Many, many OSF audience members expressed to me their concern about the future of our audience. Mm-hmm. And the racial and ethnic diversity future in the audience, the socioeconomic diversity, the age diversity of our audience. We've got a very robust student audience, and we've got a very robust older audience, and the young adult audience is not the largest part of our audience. Mm-hmm. And many audience members expressed to me concern about all those issues.
Mm-hmm.
So I think we have a ton of work to do.
Yeah.
And I do think it's our shared responsibility. I mean, when I talk to groups of supporters, I say it's up to every one of us. Who did you invite to come with you to a play?
Yeah.
And how are we collectively shifting creating access for the widest possible diversity of future audience members. And I do think it's shared responsibility. I also want to say one final thing, which is about traps that I fall into often in terms of making assumptions about people. There's also extraordinary hidden diversity in the world and not immediately visible diversity. So I just want to name that because it's a real and a powerful thing. And sometimes we make judgments about sweeping groups of people, and actually there's extraordinary diversity of experience and identity that people are bringing that we may not even take the time to notice.
I just want to add one thing about about culturally specific institutions, and if the so-called mainstream institutions diversify, does that mean that culturally specific institutions don't aren't needed anymore? I mean, I think that if you take it out of that out of the context in which we're discussing it, and you look at, I always like to look at avant-garde theaters, like theaters that are doing avant-garde work. If some of those aesthetics then influence the mainstream, does that mean that avant-garde theater no longer needs to exist? I mean, in that case, I think everyone would go, no, of course, because it's somehow easier for us to understand than it is when we put it in a culturally specific context. But the same principles apply, that there's work that gets done in avant-garde or culturally specific institutions that can only get done within those institutions, and it's important whether or not those principles then end up boomeranging into the mainstream.
Fantastic.
And I want to do just one quick follow-up because I hear this all the time, and it's always with the very best of intentions, and it's always in the midst of a conversation, a vigorous conversation about these issues of equity and how we have the most inclusive environment. And what I hear all the time is, look, these people don't like theater. They don't want to come. I mean, we can only do so much. It's not, they don't like theater. They are the people who don't. And I want to say to you all, because this is that's not true. I know you just trust me on this because I've done qualitative and quantitative research, and I can tell you that's not true. What I can tell you about people who have been historically defined as the other, and that's whether or not it is race or gender, or what I can tell you about them is they know when and where they are wanted. We almost develop a sixth sense for that. Like, we can tell you, oh, this is a good place, don't go over here. So when you set the table for them and they know, oh, this is a insert name of historically marginalized group friendly place, they will show up. They do show up. We know that to be true. So I want to say, for those of you who are, some of you might be in this room right now saying, no, it's, they just don't want to come. We do want to come. They do want to come. We will be there. Create a climate and an environment that says, we value you. We see you as fully human. And then folks don't want to go places where they're not seen as human beings. We just don't. We don't like that.
There's one more practical thing, and any little bit helps, I think, in this regard, which is to know. One of my mentors and dear friends is Michael Kaiser, who has just ended his term as the president of the Kennedy Center in D.C., and he's written really wonderful essays on diversity in the arts, and he's doing great work to foster healthy conversations around it. But one of the things he told me, which was quite enlightening, is that for larger, we're calling them mainstream organizations, sometimes we call them more white organizations, bigger budget organizations. For those organizations, almost 60%, fully 60% of their donated income is from individuals. For most theaters of color, it's about between 6 and 14%. And so, I'm not a finance person, I'm an artist person. But I do know that if you diversify your portfolio, you have less risk, right?
Yes.
So if we're completely reliant upon corporations and foundations for heavy gifts and there's an economic downturn and they tighten their belts, mm-hmm. we're in big trouble if we don't have individual donors who can be there to support us. Mm-hmm. Recently, Penumbra did hit a financial wall, and 1,400 individuals, corporations, and foundations came to our aid, one of which was OSF, mm-hmm. Campaigning on behalf of Penumbra, saying we can't let this theater company go away, mm-hmm. Which is really important leadership, I think. But that's one way that if you give to a theater company regularly, maybe figure out if there's a theater company of color in your community, mm-hmm. or a theater company that specifically works on LGBTQ issues, mm-hmm. or gender parity or access and ability, and see if you agree with their mission and you value the efforts that they're doing, mm-hmm. Give them a little bit of money.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And encourage other people by just maybe sharing their mission statement or their core value statement. Mm-hmm. Because that's important too. Yeah. So dollars can help.
Beautiful. Get involved. So I think we're going to shift gears really quickly here and open it up to all of you. And I see cards being offered. Fantastic.
Oh my goodness.
Okay. All right. Fantastic.
The audience is leaving. It's time for you now. And we've lost.
Exactly.
Where are you?
All right. Okay. So we have some questions there that were just offered. Okay.
Are they going to be read aloud, or can
yes.
people ask them themselves?
Yeah. Well, let's see.
Sure. And if anyone wants to step to the microphone, they should as uh-huh. well. Oh, first off, would you panelists say your names again?
Oh, sure. Mm-hmm. So, Lydia Garcia. Mm-hmm.
Carmen Morgan.
David Henry Hwang.
Sarah Bellamy.
Bill Rauch.
Whew.
That was an easy one. Yeah. We knew the answer to that.
First question is to Bill. Would you talk about how you are opening Shakespeare specifically to new audiences? Mm. And thank you for this event.
Yeah.
Yes. Well, again, Shakespeare is our middle name, and we are committed to sharing the whole body of work in robust productions that are as different from one another as possible. Hopefully the only thing they share is uniform excellence in different ways. There are a lot of ways to do that. You know, there are. I think that the stereotype is that older people want Elizabethan productions that are set in that era, and younger people want fresh modern interpretations. And of course, that's not completely true at all. It's much more complex. What I have said. I think everybody wants good productions that are well acted and well directed and muscularly spoken and where actors are taking emotional risks. That's what everybody wants. And something that I've said in the past is if somebody has a predilection about the period the production is set in, like I only like it when the dresses touch the floor and they're wearing mm-hmm. those beautiful costumes, or I only like it when it's completely relevant to me and it's in modern dress, I want us to do the period productions that engage the people who only want to see the stories in modern settings. And I want us to do modern productions mm-hmm. where the people who think they prefer period productions are engaged. Mm-hmm. In other words, I want the work to be so good that whatever people's aesthetic biases are when they walk in, they leave them at the door because they go on the ride.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that's what's going to engage people of all ages and all levels of experience with Shakespeare.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So I'm saying
that was a polite smattering of applause. I'm just saying. So, I wasn't asking for more. That's the response. I'd prefer to get to our Shakespeare productions, is that second one.
Funny.
Not the first one.
So I'm seeing a lot of comments in the cards, and I'd again like to invite you all to New Place and the CultureFest Lounge to unpack this mm-hmm. very, very packed topic right after the panel. But I'll move to one of those comments that says, more inclusivity, The problem resides in the room. Look around at the, quote, color, end quote, mix of this group of OSF supporters here in Ashland. Too often, if one sees a person of color, it is more likely a company member rather than a theater goer. When I suffered discrimination as a teenager and the discrimination went underground, when it was no longer socially acceptable, I wondered how to deal with that. Talk about it. Go silent and be grateful for the silence? What? And to a quick question, which is not going to be quick at all, I know. Because it is very dynamic. Ticket prices seem to get more expensive every year. It's expensive to get here and stay here for a week. Income inequality is a huge issue for the nation, and affordability strikes me as one of the largest barriers to diverse audiences. How do you balance financial health and viability versus the affordability that would assist accessibility and diversity in audiences?
Mm-hmm. Wow, mm-hmm.
That's a tough one.
That's a great one.
I feel like I need to check too.
Yeah.
I will start on that, and any of my colleagues who want to chime in, please do. It's a huge issue, and it's one we talk about a lot. Because the fact is, part of why we were able to produce such extraordinary work and hire some of the best artists and artisans and administrators in the country is because we have an audience that is willing to pay a lot of money to see our shows. And so economic access is a huge issue for us. There are I think a lot of it is how we communicate the good things that we already do. There are extraordinary access programs for locals in Southern Oregon, whether it's flex passes, whether it's the 1935 program, whether it's family days, whether it's student tickets, even specially priced groups for student groups. From certain school systems throughout the state. So there's a lot of access. There also are C-price seats, which are between $25 and $30, are available for every performance of every show all year long, every single production. So there are points of access that exist that I think sometimes people don't know about, economic access. Yes, please.
Also, food car. If something I find no one knows is that if you have an Oregon Trail card or a food card, if you call the box office and ask whether the performance is rushing, any performance that has rush tickets available with your food card or Oregon Trail card or whatever it's called in your state, you can get $5 tickets 15 minutes before the show. And you can get two $5 tickets per food card. Wow. An hour before the performance? Thank you.
Thank you for that.
Wow.
The other thing I want to say quickly is it's true. This is an expensive community. It's an expensive community to live in, and it's an expensive community to visit. And so a lot of our focus when we think about diversity is how can we invite more people with the economic means to come as tourists, as visitors, from far away, who will increase our diversity. So tourists of color and other people who've got the means to stay in Ashland, meanwhile, how can we be a better resource and more accessible to low-income people in our own backyard? Because there's extraordinary poverty in Southern Oregon, and there are really shocking statistics about the amount of poverty in our state and in our part of the state. And how can we be more responsible and create more access for people of limited economic means in our own backyard? So I think, again, we could go on for 2-3 hours on this topic. It's a very emotional one. It's a vitally important one. And I'm grateful for whoever wrote that on the card to name it.
Thank you. May I just also say that your leadership on diversity and inclusion in the field could be a campaign. I mean, for affluent patrons who love Oregon Shakespeare Festival to say, we want, help us bring other people here, you know, and donate money specifically to do that. I mean, I think to Carmen's point about just how visible the work is, that I would support that. I'd put some money in that. I'm not affluent, though, so I'll just be a little bit of money.
One thing that, you know, I live in New York, and obviously the question of the cost of theater and the degree to which it exacerbates the income divide, or, you know, it does in our country is a huge one. One example that I was really happy to be associated with was I was the residency one playwright for a playwright called Signature, for a theater called Signature Theater in New York that devotes a season to the work of a single author. And, you know, they raised, Jim Houghton, the artistic director and founder, you know, they raised money specifically to subsidize tickets. Mm-hmm. And so as a result, every seat of every performance in that theater in the initial announced run is $25. And so I was very proud to be at a theater that was able to have affordable tickets. And I think that there are ways to, there are institutions and foundations and even, in their case, a venture capitalist who you know, gave them $10 million to subsidize tickets for 20 years. It was 20 mm-hmm. million or something. And
once you get $10 million, it doesn't matter.
So anyway, there's it is a big issue and something that needs to be addressed along with the racial and ethnic diversity issues is income diversity.
Mm-hmm. You know, and I would just add to that just very quickly, which is that in addition to everything that's already been said, because I do think it's a complicated, multi-pronged approach, but you know, I hope I'm not overly simplifying this, but I do know that, I mean, those Beyonce and Jay-Z tickets are expensive. Mm-hmm. And I think that community, folks prioritize what speaks to them and what connects with them and what, you know what I mean? So I feel like, and I know, I don't mean to be disrespectful and oversimplify this, but folks will put their money where they, you know, find value and feel speaks to them. So just put that out there.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. So I think we might have time for maybe one more question, right? Okay.
Maybe this will take one. Wow, I probably shouldn't have said that.
Uh-oh.
Should theater try to draw in such groups as Tea Party Republicans, and to what purpose?
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. I'll just quickly just say my piece on that is absolutely, absolutely. And I think that theater does. I think so. I think that it, because of what I said earlier, which was that I want to see, can we share our humanity with each other? Mm-hmm. Can you see me as human? I want to see you as human. I feel that the power of theater to bridge that divide. So absolutely, absolutely. And I believe that is already happening. I don't think theater is seen as so, so liberal that I leave this to the experts here.
I think people love theater from every political position and ideology as long as they've been welcomed. And usually because someone said, come with me. Mm-hmm. As a child or a young adult, they were introduced to theater and they saw the magic of it. I mean, that's why we all love theater, because even if you know where all the pulleys and things are, you still go, whoa! Mm-hmm. And that's really cool. And I think one of the things that we tend to lament a bit at Penumbra is we are often preaching to the choir, you know? Mm. We're often having these really important conversations with people who already agree. And so ideally, we're giving them skills and tools to go out and share. But it would be great if people could come in and be part of those conversations and see those plays. And because I think that would push us to understand what we're doing better. You know, I think if you get in an echo chamber, you're not going to grow. So I would welcome it.
When our American Revolution's plays, when I have audience members self-identify as being on opposite extremes of the political spectrum and talk about how engaged, how moved, mm-hmm. how challenged they were by a piece, mm-hmm. then I feel like we are doing what we're here to do.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Great question.
Yeah. I think we're at the time, but I have at least seven great questions that I think would be a great starter for the Culture Fest unpack at New Place right after this. I hope to see folk come out and continue this conversation at least for the next hour. Thank you for your
absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. Thank you. So, I mean, thank you. Like, you know, we cannot thank you enough for joining us today. You know, I mean, clearly, you know, we're having this conversation. We want this conversation to come out from behind closed doors and to include all of you because, you know, we do this work together. You know, art requires three elements, the artist, the work of art, and the audience to receive it. So without you, we're just playing for ourselves, and that's no fun. So so for our audience, both physical and virtual, thank you, HowlRound. Thank you for joining us this morning. We could not do this work without your passionate, dedicated, vociferous participation in what we do. And we also invite you to continue the conversation. So as Rob said, we will some of us will be going to the CultureFest Lounge right now. We'd love to mingle, hear your questions. But there will also be a free facilitated conversation with Carmen. And Carmen will be there for you, the audience.
I won't be on the stage.
No, you won't be on the stage. You will not be on the stage. That conversation called Whose Theater Is This? The Audience Speaks is happening on Sunday, September 14th at 4:30 p.m. in the Culture Fest Lounge, not on the stage.
Right.
And it is meant to be a conversation. So by all means, join us then. You know, we will continue talking. We would love to hear, you know, what is bubbling up for you, what questions you have, what perspectives you have, because it only enriches our work, really. So.
Well done, Lydia.
Thank you.
Lydia. Lydia Garcia.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody.
Thanks. Have a wonderful day.
All right.
That was great.
You were awesome.